subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon to get the latest updates.
Volcanoes are in the news again. A few days ago, Mount Etna in Italy erupted and continues to erupt, and then the Sinabung in Indonesia went off. And now we're also expecting volcanoes to go off in Iceland soon. But these volcanoes are all of different types and with different kinds of eruptions. In this video, we'll take a look at the basics of volcanoes, what their different kinds are, what different types of eruptions are and how they occur, and what are some of the most destructive volcanoes in history and how they've shaped society. I'm Sandhya Ramesh and this is Pure Science. When we think of volcanoes, we typically picture large mountaintops blowing off their peak, ejecting large amounts of fiery lava in a spectacular light show. But these are just one kind of volcanoes and one kind of volcanic eruption. There are three main kinds of volcanoes. Volcanic fields, such as the ones found in Iceland and New Zealand, are where small eruptions take place over a wide geographic area. These eruptions take place spaced out over long periods of time, such as hundreds of thousands of years. A volcanic field can consist of 10 or even up to 100 volcanoes, and lava sometimes constantly flows out of the crust in a slow process. Each eruption in the field creates a new volcano, but these new volcanoes do not erupt again. Cone volcanoes or stratovolcanoes are what we picture in the form of a mountain that erupts from only one location, usually the peak or the top. These form over centuries as lava erupts from the top of the cone and then settles on the cone itself, raising the height of the cone gradually over a period of thousands of years. Caldera volcanoes are formed when a volcano goes off and this empties a chamber of magma underneath. The top rock then collapses because there's nothing to support it structurally, and this then forms a basin-shaped hollow called a caldera or a caldera that basically looks like a crater. In volcanic terms, magma is molten rock that's under the ground, and when it reaches the surface, it's called lava. And of course, volcanoes can also be active or dormant or extinct. Just like every other science, we do need to study lava flow and volcanism in the lab. So how do volcanologists model lava flows in the lab? Turns out the recipe uses corn syrup, baking soda, and citric acid. This mixture is poured down slopey surfaces, and this can be especially useful to study how bubbles affect lava flow. Corn syrup is commonly used to model lava flows because its viscosity or thickness can be tweaked, as anyone who's used it in cooking would know. Calderas can be modeled using just flour in the lab and simulating a collapse of the crust. But with all these different kinds of volcanoes, lava flows differently as well, and there are different kinds of eruptions too. In general, volcanic eruptions are classified into two types, effusive and explosive. Effusive eruptions are the ones where there is outpouring of magma, so the volcano constantly leaks lava. This lava flows quickly and smoothly, and it's less viscous and has less gas content. On the other hand, explosive eruptions are what we're most familiar with and picture when we think of volcanic eruptions. As the name suggests, the volcano explodes. The magma is pushed out by pressurized gas that builds up inside, and this magma is actually much more viscous, and of course these eruptions release a ton of gases as well. Of these two, the explosive ones are far more dangerous and deadly. Let's look at the process of an explosive eruption which occurs in cone volcanoes. First, there is some kind of blockage which prevents gases under the ground from being released immediately. These gases tend to be primarily water vapor, but also other gases like carbon dioxide, sulfur dioxide, hydrogen sulfide, methane, carbon monoxide, and even just hydrogen. Other gases and compounds are present as well, but these are the primary gases that come out through volcanism. As you might have guessed, most of them are very powerful greenhouse gases. These gases are mixed with the magma that is already extremely viscous, and this viscous magma traps the gases inside of it. So the pressure keeps building up inside until a breaking point is reached where there is an explosive eruption. This typically occurs in the weakest part of the cone, which is usually the top. This release causes an eruption column, which is the long column of ash, rocks, gas, and dust cloud we see when we see images of volcanoes. Explosive eruptions can send tephra, the name for any ejected volcanic material, and pyroclastic material, which is pieces of rocks and dust and gas and ash, up to 20 kilometers into the atmosphere at speeds of hundreds of meters a second and a volume of hundreds of thousands of tons of material a second. When the gases then mix in the atmosphere, the pressure of the material that has been ejected drops and it can no longer be held up in the air. Gravity then takes over and all of this material comes crashing down in what is called a pyroclastic flow. This is the most dangerous and destructive part of an explosive volcano. Ash and rock, which can be as hot as 500 to 700 degrees Celsius, comes crashing down the slopes of a volcano and travels up to speeds of 80 kilometers per hour. The material is too hot and moves too fast. It destroys everything in its path, including human settlements, buildings, and vegetation. We have seen in a previous video about Pompeii and how it was destroyed in the year 79 AD. The city of Pompeii and other regions in the Roman Empire were essentially buried under massive pyroclastic flows of rock and ash that was expelled for up to 33 kilometers into the air. This then fell down from the sky for long periods of time after Mount Vesuvius erupted explosively. Sometimes, if it's winter and there's snow on the volcanic slopes, the pyroclastic material will mix with water and form lahars, which are highly destructive mud flows in the form of slushy material or a slurry, but of course, boiling hot and extremely destructive. Then, all of this pyroclastic material falls down and deposits on the Earth's surface in a pyroclastic fall. This settling can happen over distances spanning hundreds of kilometers, depending on how explosive a volcano was, because the material that rises up in the eruption column gets dispersed by wind currents. The famous Krakatoa eruption, which we'll look at in a little bit, had a pyroclastic fall that covered nearly 800,000 square kilometers. The ash cloud from the eruption circled the earth for nearly 2 weeks. And when volcanoes eject this much ash and gas into the atmosphere, it can alter global temperatures and block out sunlight for days. This can also occur in effusive flows in which lava steadily oozes out of a volcano onto the ground, like the ground is leaking lava constantly. These eruptions can actually go on for years and years, and they form layers and layers of volcanic rocks. These form structures like shield volcanoes, which look like a warrior shield, or lava domes, which can in turn produce explosive eruptions. Sometimes, all kinds of volcanic flows and explosions mix together, as they have in the past, and form large stretches of land called traps. These are igneous provinces. There are two notable traps historically, and these are the Siberian traps and the Deccan traps. The Deccan traps formed about 66 million years ago, just before the dinosaurs went extinct, and began at the Western Ghats. The lava flow from here created about half the land in India on which we walk, and of course, erosion and plate tectonics has changed how it looks now. But when the Deccan traps were active, they were constantly releasing lava and gases. And in fact, before we could confirm the asteroid impact theory, many scientists did believe that it was the volcanism from Deccan traps and the constant outgassing from this event that contributed to the mass extinction. It's likely that the volcanism was intensified by the asteroid impact, is what we think now. Whenever we think of the most destructive volcanoes, the first example that comes to many people's minds is the Krakatoa eruption of 1883, which some of us might be familiar with. It was one of the most destructive volcanic events in recorded history. It occurred in the Indonesian island of Krakatoa, and almost 75% of the volcanic island and its surrounding smaller islands were destroyed. It produced the loudest sound in recorded history too. The explosive sounds of multiple eruptions, and especially the third eruption, which was the loudest, was heard as far away as Australia and London and places in Africa. And the sound actually traveled around the globe 7 times, and it was picked up by instruments. The eruption ruptured the eardrums of sailors out at sea nearly 65 kilometers away from the volcanic event. The pressure wave from this event was recorded on pressure meters all over the world. This volcano propelled ash up to a distance of 80 kilometers into the atmosphere, and the ash spread across the globe. This created many interesting effects for several days. Firstly, it darkened the sky globally and lowered global temperatures by about 0.4 degrees Celsius because more sunlight was getting reflected. The sulfur dioxide that was released from this event traveled high up into the atmosphere and blocked out sunlight, and also caused a record amount of rainfall in 1883 to 1884 in many places around the globe. There was also then subsequently acid rain that fell in many parts of the world. The particles in the atmosphere caused spectacularly fiery sunsets, and in fact there are accounts where the fire department was called in to put out what citizens thought were actual fires. For many years, the moon appeared blue and green because the ash in the atmosphere scattered red light and allowed other colors to pass through. Even the sun at times appeared lavender in color. We have records of what this looked like visually because these are all documented in art. The most famous of these, of course, is Edvard Munch's The Scream, which is thought to be what he saw when he looked out of his window in Norway after the eruption occurred. But Krakatoa was not the most destructive explosion in recorded history. Volcanic explosions are ranked on a scale called Volcanic Explosivity Index. It is a logarithmic scale, much like earthquakes are on the Richter scale. It is open-ended from 0 to 8, and 8 is the most destructive, often given to supervolcanoes. Krakatoa was rated a 6, while the Mount Tambora explosion in 1815 was rated 7. This explosion is the largest eruption in recorded human history and is the largest explosive eruption in the past 10,000 years. This was also in Indonesia, and it led to a global cooling event called the Year Without Summer in 1816. Global temperatures plummeted by 0.7 degrees Celsius, and it caused a volcanic winter, blocking out sunlight the entire time. This year was in fact the coolest year between 1766 and the year 2000. It had major consequences for agriculture and resulted in global crop failure. There was a massive famine in many parts of the world. There were food riots, crops were damaged because of frost, there were historic floods, and there were also disease outbreaks like that of cholera. In many countries, there was persistent smog in the air for a very long time. It dimmed the sunlight so much that people could actually see sunspots on the sun with their naked eyes. It is thought that the lack of oats after the Tambora eruption was what led to the invention of velocipedes, or those early versions of bicycles that we see. There was incessant rainfall in all of Europe and especially in Switzerland, because of which Lord Byron and Mary Shelley were confined indoors, and Lord Byron came up with the challenge of writing the scariest horror story. Mary Shelley wrote Frankenstein. A lot of the effects of the eruption is also captured in art. Then going back even earlier, in 1783, the Laki volcano in Iceland released so much sulfur dioxide that all of the country's livestock died, and this caused a famine that led to the death of a quarter of the people on the island. Temperatures dropped by almost 1 degree Celsius, and it led to very severe weather. In France, the extreme weather events and famine that persisted for several years led to increased poverty, and this is thought to have contributed to the French Revolution. Many other volcanoes in the past have also shaped human history. The Hekla 3 eruption, again in Iceland in the year 1000 BCE, is thought to have led to the collapse of the Bronze Age, and people started to migrate westward. This is a contested theory, but it did drop the world temperatures for nearly two decades. Some volcanic winters caused by eruptions thousands of years ago, such as the Toba super eruption in Sumatra, also dropped global temperatures and accelerated the incoming ice age about 73,000 years ago, and it is thought to have reduced the population of our human ancestors then to around just 15,000 individuals and narrowed down our gene pool.